salvation has been brought down. Amen. I am so humbly honored and privileged to stand before you today. You have chosen me, the others, but you chose me. And I thank you for the opportunity. I want to thank Brother Barry for his always encouragement and his coolness. And just remember, on June 22nd is my birthday. But he is a good man, isn't he? He has done a great job. I know that he's a leader of the Dallas Preachers Association. He's also on the committee of the Christian Basketball League. And I remember my dad dragging me down to Seeking Hills River Recreation Center and all over the place for basketball. And along the day, they've been there since 4 o'clock. And one of them always falls asleep on the scoreboard. And Dallas has always come out on top. So he didn't tell you that. But anyway, it's good. And to the shepherds that are here, those that look after the flock here, and those that look after the church, we thank you. And also to the church and the sisters. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you so much. So I won't be there alone. So by the time you need to blink an eye or nod your head, I'll be done. But Sister T. Hayes told me, just stick with the Bible. And you'll be all right if God is with. I'm also humbled to be here as my mother. Amen. She's in the back. And I know when I get home, there's going to be some good cooking in the box. Did you cook? No. So it's so good that she's always here and supports me. I thank you so much for that. My sister is here. And she is her last year of college, amen. So, Jillian, raise your hand. She's at Northwestern. She's a Bayou now. She's going to Louisiana. Joy is here, amen. And Junior and my brother is here. Marlon is here, amen. So, I know I got to be good today. And he's going to tell me. And then, I didn't know they was going to come today. They found a way of lying, but I'll ask for forgiveness. But the twins, Alicia and Maisha, are here, and their friend Keisha. And my Aunt Jacqueline is here from Mount Pleasant, Texas, amen. And so I'm gonna show out a little bit because I got my people with me. So I thank them so much for their encouragement. I thank y'all and Sister Barry, it's good to see you. And I know y'all have two daughters, and I thank them and their friends. But Dallas West, you have an adopted son now in me. Okay? So Brother Barry, you didn't know that, but tonight. We're going to get to the word today, and then I'll take my seat, and I'm so thankful. Again, I'm so thankful for this opportunity. And so I didn't get a topic. I got called on Monday to come and deliver a message. Didn't know which way I wanted to go, because in your mind, you always want, you have so much to say. But I came to a topic that kind of old school topic. 99 problems, and Jesus is not one. If you know, you might know that song back in the day. Look, and they're like, yeah, that's me. Yeah, 99 problems, and Jesus is not one. I took it from the Bible of John 14, verse 6, when Thomas asked, Father, you know not whether thou goest nor the way. And Jesus responded, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I want to sing, because old Dog and Jolly can sing, boy. Sing. And I think those are read the scriptures, but maybe after this I will do the invitation song. You go to the next slide, please, and it has some scripture there. We're going to go from a PowerPoint, so, and I apologize for my technology. Brother Barry told me to 55 fun, and I was disobedient, so I just kind of sing it, and I Google Docs it, so we're going to go through this. But when you look at 99 problems and Jesus is not one, there's a lot of problems in our world today, is it not?
Yes, sir.
You know, being in the school district for 10 years, and I was at West Mesquite for a while, and then I had an opportunity to open up a new school. And that was a long, brutal process for me.
Yeah.
And I understand that even though you go up there to the north side of town, there's still problems in this world today. Don't change. Money don't solve problems. Builders don't solve problems. The only one that can solve problems is Jesus Almighty. And so I grew up there, but it's still the same problem, just a different types of people around this world. Notice some facts here. One out of three black males will go to prison in a lifetime. The number one cause of death for African Americans, males, from the age of 15 to 34 is murder. One out of three African American men, ages 18 24 are unemployed. 50%, and then from age 18 to 24, 25%, 30%, and then from age 25 to 34, 30% people, African American males are unemployed right now. That's trouble. That's problems in our world today. So what are we going to do today? I'm going to take you through three problems because I know if I spend all the time going through 99 problems, I'm going to become a problem. So that ain't going to happen to me today. But the first one I want to take you through is the undervalue of our lives. Number two, exposing too much on the wrong gaps. And number three, I like this little, you might know this song, this here, Lifestyle. That's a lifestyle that we live. The young people gonna feel me on this a little bit. This here lifestyle. Let's look at the undervalue of our lives for just a minute. You might know that a journey from Trayvon Martin, age 17. It occurred on February the 26th, 2012, in Sanford, Florida. I'm gonna move around a little bit. Can you still hear me? So here he is. He went to go visit his dad down at a resort for a while. There previously, a guy by the name of George Zimmerman was at his house. And Trayvon Martin went to the store to go get a little drink, a little, what kind of candy you like? Snickers? Skittles. Yeah, got Skittles. Taste the rainbow. Yeah, that's another problem, man. And so he had a hood on. He had a hood on, and there, previously knew the weeks there had been robberies down in that neighborhood. And Brother Mr. Zimmerman said, well, that's a male with a hood on. And I've been concerned about my neighborhood because of robbery. Yes. So he called the police. He said, look, there's a black male that's running around the neighborhood, and I just want you to come check it out. The officer said, okay, well, I'll be there in a while. But don't you go messing with the young boy. Don't go messing with him. Well, that little fool went to go messing with him. He was told not to, and then young boy, what are you doing in my neighborhood? He said, sir, I'm just trying to get some candy and a little drink and just going about my way. Well, you're cutting through the neighborhoods. You shouldn't be in these neighborhoods. There a tussle happened and he shot the young man. 17. Then he would just go up a little northwest, east to Missouri. Michael Brown was at the store. And he stole some cigars. I'll get to that later. He stole some cigars, him and his friends, and they began to take off, and the store manager called. Said, hey, there's been a robbery at the store, and gave a description of these males. But finally, they stopped him and confronted him, and the young boy finally started running out there and started shooting. He started running, and the cops kept up to him and caught up to him and turned around, and 12 bullets was fired on Michael Brown. Next slide, please. You're going to get the story. A Freddie Gray, 25 years old. They thought he had a little cut, just a box cutter knife. Six police officers were suspended from the force on Freddie Gray. And not recently here in McKinney, you heard of a pool party. Sad thing is, some of those kids go to my school. And it was so sad to see them on the news, and the young boy who recorded that, you know, I pass in the hall about every day. So they had a pool party, about to turn it up. Turn up. It was too many of us though. Too many of us. And we turned up too much. We turned up, we were praying that Superman and swimming. Ain't no else telling what was going on, man. It got too loud, and some people in the neighborhood said, look, it's too many of them in there. There's too many of them. And they came, and then the young girl, you saw the video. Young girl pinned down, just ain't got no value to her life. Your life's gonna be my life. It's undervalued right now. And I know I'm gonna be hypocrite. I'm biased about both. Because there is racial profiling in the world today. It still is. Dr. King tried to fight it a long time ago, but there still is. Let me show you a prime example. I wear a shirt and a tie about 5 years ago. I've been wearing a shirt and a tie to work. And so, it impresses people and some things like that. And so I go to the interview in Frisco. And I get there, there's a group of five. And they say, I can't believe that you wear a shirt and a tie to work. I said, why not? I'm professional. It's still there today. I come on time. But what I'm trying to
trying to say is, guys, whether you do it or not, it's under your lives under matter. I believe that somehow somebody said this, I can get many of you gone and off the streets if you're a better place. I'm telling you that right now. You are walking through, you walk through the doors of life, you already walk. She's gonna turn it up. She ghetto. She hood. He ain't nobody. He gonna be gone. I can't trust him. I'm just telling you, young man, what I did. You know, I laughed and they said, well, you know, I'll try to understand. And they want you gone. They don't want you to make it. And so you look at our lives today, what does that tell us today? Now I want to tell you this too, young people. In Job chapter 14 and 1, he says, a man, a boy, that is one of a woman is full of trouble. And I tell my kids all the time, don't stack trouble on top of trouble. You know you already got one, you already trouble. But be careful how you do things in life. Don't add no trouble in this world. You know, that's another thing. I said, our pride is so bad in African Americans, especially. You know, pride, we everybody disrespecting me. You don't know me. Sometimes it's not about that. It's really not about it. You've been questioning your manhood all the time. So I'm not telling you to be soft. I'm not telling you to stand up. What I'm telling you is that as your life is undervalued, don't cause no trouble in what it is. Go to work. You ain't got to be nobody's friend. I go to work. I don't go, hey, I work and I go home. Am I right? I keep reaching for a little bit, but not for long. Because my life is undervalued. And it's just, it don't scare me. You should, I'm not telling you to walk out and I ain't afraid of nothing. God didn't give you the power of fear. But understand, humble yourself sometimes in this life. You know, well, how you doing today? Why are you asking me? Look how you come at people. And you want people to respect you? Look what we do. If you ever come to a place day down at First Road where there ain't no shooting, there ain't no fighting, there's no beef among ourselves. But right now in the world today, they say when they get us together, we turn up. And then you walk around and you wear a hood on, don't talk to him. Oh, come on. Just go to the store and see yourself. People are scared of it. And then when you talk with sense, they still don't believe you. People don't care about your life, son. The undervalue of your life. They'd rather bury you right now at a young age. So this world can be a better chance. They ain't trying to give you another chance in life. You know, another thing I don't like is, and I'm going to get to this, is that everything that we do is always exposed so much. Too much. It's like they just want to make us as an example. When you look at some scriptures here, as I came before, you know, before Dr. King and Malcolm X fought these fights, someone named Jesus. Somebody named Jesus. He came down and said, I see all this division among all my people. But it ain't about that life. Not about the undervalues of life. So he said in Galatians 3 and chapter 28, there is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free. There's male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. You know what I tell people? Talk about it. Come on, bring it on. Because you know what you can get? Jesus, the one that holds my life, got all of the value that I need. You look in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 14 and 15. For he himself is our peace. We look around this world and see, Jesus is my peace. Can't no man hold me down. You ain't got no value on me, son. Because my man Jesus is over here. And he says, who has made two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. So bring on this world here. I hold on to Jesus, not man. When I know at the end of the day my life will have some value, but I'm sitting down here and you're going to roll me out. You ain't going to have to talk about he was a good man. You're going to know that I was a good man because of the value of my life. So I'm going to tell you, don't play this game like you just all this and that. Okay? Humble yourself. Be respectful. Don't put yourself in those situations where your lives will be undervalued. If not, they'll be rid of it. You don't have no value left in your life. Point number two, exposing too much on the wrong apps. I like these apps, don't y'all? I got a lot of apps. I've left my phone up there, but I got Huddle, I got a Facebook, I have MySpace, that's kind of out of MySpace. I got a Twitter now. I don't have Snapshot. See there, that's what I'm saying? I don't have that Snapshot. I don't have all that. That's okay. Thank you. It'll upgrade me a little bit, okay? I don't have all that in my life right now. Now, I got Skype, but Skype is old, right? I have Voodoo. What is it, Voodoo?
Instagram. Y'all got Instagram? Okay, I don't have that. I just have Twitter, Facebook, and what's that yellow? But media has evolved around, and that's right, old people, it evolved. How many of y'all old people got cell phones in here? You got the flip? How many of y'all got iPhone 6? iPhone 7 will be out in October, so it's going to be great, but it has changed our society into where it's a form of communication, and I love it. It's an easy way to just get me on Facebook. I know Brother Gray has YouTube, and so it's all over the place, and it's so great, but it also becomes detrimental to our lives. You know, you just look around, there's twerking videos everywhere. Yes, they're posing. And I just call it false advertising. And then you got these dating websites. You know, I'm young and not married, so you know, you try to see what's out there, you know, just to see. I'm gonna go in and tell them myself, just to see a little bit. Yeah, see what it is. You got to know. Yeah. All right, let me keep going. But anyway, I just feel that you have to be careful what you put on there. You really do. I was just, you know, you just look and, you know, and I look at profile like, okay, oh. And I look at videos, and we trace our kids now on Twitter. We have to do this. I'm going to show you an example here. You turn to the next slide. And Yuri Wright was a great football player in 2012. And he lost a scholarship at the University of Michigan because of a Twitter post. And then look into this happening. According to a new survey conducted on the Vice Research, 1 in 10 people aged 16 to 34. I think I'm 34. And how old are you? 14, two more years. How old are you, sir? Oh, that's you. Yeah. Well, have been turned down for a job. J-O-B. Get your job, Greg. You can't get a job, Greg. Turned down something to have posted on a social media website. There's, I recall, I was at West Mesquite, and we was number 3 in the area. And we were getting ready to play Poteet Middle School. I mean, Poteet. I said, that's why I don't like it now, Robbins. And we had a guy, I won't call his name out of disrespect to him, stood safely, full ride to Texas A&M. A quarterback, full ride to Arizona State. We loaded. Loaded. Then we get on Twitter one day, and they put down, I'm going to make sure I knock you out. The young mother saw that. Next morning, went to the SRO of the school. Said, look at this, my son is not going to play their strengths. Let me tell you this, West Mesquite, I was there, and I'll tell you why I left West Mesquite, to be honest with you. I love West Mesquite, I went to West Mesquite High School. Raised in Mesquite, Texas. But West Mesquite had a bad nap. At the Warriors Stadium, the biggest stadium in Texas right now. And you like football, don't you? Everybody. Over a little tweet. And I'm going to knock you out of the game. I'm going to knock you out. So they got back in downtown, all the way to the superintendent. She's furious about it. Mention those guys have to sit out. We ended up winning the game in double overtime because you hold us back. That's a mindset. But for the young boys being a senior here, you can't play one of the biggest games that you ever played. It's bad because of social media. You also got to get rid of social media predators up there. People acting like women. And they're really men. Just a while ago I read that a young man met this young lady on social media. And when he got to the house, he said, he here. And two guys came from behind the house and robbed him. And he didn't have no money. And he ended up dying. Just be careful of social media today. Just be careful. It can cost you a job, cost you a scholarship. If you don't even have to tweet it or post it. If you retweet it or post it, you just as liable. Be careful with your videos too. Y'all video stuff, everybody hot. They want the hottest thing got to be on the media. What are you looking for? How many likes you get? Ain't about that.
Let Jesus like you a little bit.
You'll be all right.
You still don't get what you get. I put stuff on there. A lot of kids are putting a lot of emotions on there too. Tearing our families. How you feel right now? I don't do all that. Then you put where you want to go. I don't even know where I've been all the time. They follow you. I've got enough people following me. I don't need anybody else following me and stopping me.
Paul wrote these words in chapter 5. You remember, he was trying to tell the believers.
Yeah.
He said, walk in the light as Jesus that you already knew have created you. Stay away from all that filthiness and things that you see. Instead of you exposing that, expose that stuff that is wrong. Don't encourage it and keep it going. People. Don't keep that stuff going. So Paul was telling those believers that you are somebody else now.
Is this your lifestyle? You know, I was there today, you know, one day in the car.
Y'all done did it, get alive, on his own lifestyle. You hear that? A lot of friends, his name is Coach Jones. He's about 26 years old, 27. And we coached him, and he's from Decatur, Texas. Little country small town. I mean, you look at life and you see things like that. We have emotions. Sometimes our emotions get the best of us. We have a lack of education. Sometimes also I think we're too much sports driven. I know I hate, I love sports. But sometimes our kids feel like that's the way out of life. They don't get a D1 scholarship, they don't. So I work hard to get them a Division II, a Division III scholarship. They're not appreciative of that. So I think sometimes too much sports driven as parents, we, my son is this, my son is that, and a lot of kids get burnt out, don't want to play no more. But their daddy yelling, I'm like, just be quiet, I can't coach your kid, because you yelling. Come to practice, let me coach you up. And then I put this down, I cry. You know, I'm a black African-American male in this world, and I understand that for you guys, we have a chip on our shoulder to prove. But I'm also humble. I don't fight every battle. I said, well, anyway, if it is yours, let it be. Because I feel like this, I'm always going to get on top. So they make decisions, and I just sit there and laugh and say, well, Josh, I think we'll go with your decision. I said, that's cool, great. But I have my pride don't get in the way of me, because sometimes we can be too prideful. So be careful. There's two stories and parables I close. In Luke chapter 18, verses 18 to 23, you hear the parable of the rich young ruler. And I put that chain on, and the chain ain't low. Anyway, the rich young ruler, he came to Jesus. He said, Jesus, what must I do to inherit the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus said, well, do this, do that, do all the things. He said, this I kept from my youth up. So Jesus said, if you really want to inherit heaven, my man, sell your riches. Sell your riches. Give it to the poor. And when he heard this, he went away sad. How in the world can someone be too rich for God? God ain't afraid of you. You
too rich if you can't set it for man to give it back. Are you valuing too much in your life? You're rich. You're too rich for God that you can't give your life away. You too caught up in your lifestyle that the man that has your life, that gave you your life, you can't give it back to him. You're too rich for God. So you'd rather keep all your riches and die in vain. What was a man proud to gain the whole world? Got it all. Money. It ain't about the money. You know that one. Don't be coming at me, right? Everybody trying to get a dollar now. Try to give away some of your riches and your, to the poor. Leave that lifestyle and come to Jesus. Then lastly, there is a story about the prodigal son. I just did this on Father's Day. Hey, Daddy, give me what's mine. Now, I wish I could do that now, but I'll probably be living at my own teeth right now. I ain't nothing mine. So give me my portion. And the Bible says about a third. And the young boy had an older son, but the younger boy got a little chest up a little bit. And the daddy didn't worry. He said, here, son, give me. Here you go, man. Go. The young boy went up to a foreign country, and he began to live life. But he ran out. Had to get a job. He was now at part of his life, he was living with pigs, eating pig slop. But the good thing about him, that the rich young ruler did, he came to himself. Ignorance didn't set in too long. His stubbornness, he can be still, I can do this all by myself. No, he came to himself. And then he began to say, when I get to my father, I will say, Father, I've sinned against thee and not worthy to be your son. But then when the father saw him from a distance. I'm not going to take off the run. I haven't stretched yet. But he took off and hugged his son and showed love. Now, there's two things. The rich young ruler didn't come to himself enough. But what I want you to understand, young people, before you get to rock bottom, I want you to come to yourself as soon as you can and come to Jesus before it's everlasting too late. To die in riches is to die in vain, but to die in the Lord is gain. What do you want to be in your lifestyle this day? And in closing, I brought a picture of two. When you look at this picture here, solving the problem is where Thomas came in at. In John chapter 14 and 6, is where I got the sudden. I'm going to bring it all home to you now. Before Thomas decided to go off anywhere, he asked a question. Father, I know not the way. Before I go strumming off into my own way, I need to ask you a question. Father, what is the way? Before I go into problems that I can't understand, the trials of dark on every hand, things that I can't understand. When we look at this picture here, it says, next section is God's way. My way, no exit. No exit. There's no exit in your way. Ain't nothing. We're going down and down and down. And when judgment ain't come, your exit is down. But if you get with God, when you get with God, there's an exit door that says heaven. So let me ask you a question. Before you go beyond the value of life, there is a way. Before you expose too much, expose the truth of life. And if you want to hear a good lifestyle, go to the man that gives you everlasting life. It is so true. There's one thing wrong with the picture on the right. There's no cause taking this. This is the less road travel in our young lives today. Look at that. Look at that road. It's not fun. It seems really boring and pleasing. It's not. For all the people, they like sightseeing. They love it. Give them some trees and give me some, couple of peas and red bone. I'm all right. For the young people, that road seems too boring. But I want to tell you, that boring road that you don't want to travel right now is the right way to go. It's the only way to go for your life. If you want to value your life, you want to expose the right things. He want to be in the right lifestyle. You heard the word. I true that you believe the truth. I hope that you will expose that life and confess the sweetest name of Jesus. And when you've done that, you'll be in a great lifestyle. And you won't have problems. I'm going to tell you this. You're going to have problems, young people. But your outlook on the problems are great. And like, is that all right? I thank you so much for your time. And to listen to this. Young people, I'm with you. I'm done too. I'm still learning how to crawl. It's every day. I'm running some, and when I don't go, I'm asking like Thomas. Lord, show me the way. Show me this way. I don't want to give up. But young people right now, they're ready to give up and just shoot themselves. There ain't a way to go in life. There's a way that God said. We stand, we're going to say, show me the way. And as you come, I desire you to come, whether you old or age or young, to come. Show me the way. I say, Lord, I need you to show me the way. I said, I am God.
Show.